Consistent faith in uncertain circumstances. Not many topics that I've spoken on has hit me to the core like this one. You know, when you know something, when you've been there, well, I haven't been there, I'm still there. So the idea of persistent faith, it really hit me. And I remember as I thought about it one night, as I said, I started to cry. And even when I was in Kingston, because I went up from Thursday evening, Thursday night, you know, did a last father with short boots, I needed to sleep, and then took off in the night. And Friday night, after a hectic day, I mean, I got into my aunt's place at around maybe 5, and I was struggling to stay awake, and I kind of stepped off, didn't get up back until 3 o'clock in the morning. That would have been Saturday morning. And as I got up, you know, went and changed my clothes, because I was still in the clothes that I had on this morning. And I lay down there, and again, I was up for maybe over 20 minutes, just thinking about the topic. And I've been praying that the Lord keep me, because I don't look pretty when I start to cry. And I'd like you all to have a good image in your memory. But I'm going to ask you to pray for me as well as I go through this. And it's difficult because sometimes the Spirit speaks to you on some stuff, you know, if you have some of the medicine you have to take for yourself. And so this morning, consistent faith through uncertain circumstances. And I want us to turn to a passage of scripture I was going through with my Sunday school class. Daniel chapter 3. And I'm just going to read verses 8 down to 12. But essentially, I'm dealing with the entire chapter, but I read verses 8 down to 12. For you will read it from the New King James Version, Daniel chapter 3. Therefore, at that time, certain Chaldeans came forward and accused the Jews. They spoke and said to the king Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. You, O king, have made a decree that everyone who hears the song of the horn, flute, harp, lyre, and psaltery in symphony with all kinds of music shall fall down and worship the gold image. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. There are certain Jews whom you have set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not paid due regards to you. They do not serve your gods or worship the gold image which you have set up. Fathers, we spend these few moments in your word. Lord, I pray that you forgive me of all my trespasses and sins, those I know about and those I don't know about, that are done in ignorance. Father, prepare me to be used as your vessel. And I pray that you will speak through me. Let me not be at the forefront, but that your word, your spirit will take charge. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Consistent faith through uncertain circumstances. We live in a world that is always changing. And with so much change, consistency often falls to the wayside. It's always about bigger and better, but not as often about stability and lasting. The Apostle Paul says in Philippians 4:11-13, not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatever state I am, therewith to be content. And I know both how to obey, be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things, I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. And this familiar verse, I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. How did Paul learn to be content in any and all situations, no matter how good or how bad? It was by consistent faith. Job was consistent in his faith even while enduring the loss of his property and the death of his children, only then to be afflicted with painful sores that covered his entire body. But through it all, Job remained faithful to God. David A. Bednar says, ordinary people who faithfully, diligently, and consistently do simple things that are right before God will bring forth extraordinary results. Most of us are not consistent spiritually because we are more concerned about being consistent with the external. As I go through the passage of Daniel chapter 3, we see that consistent faith was brought into action. We know the story of the three Hebrew boys, one of the first, perhaps, Bible stories we would have heard in Sunday school. Next to David and Goliath, we would have heard about the three Hebrew boys and the fiery furnace. Now, what was happening in the passage? King Nebuchadnezzar, the chapter before, chapter 2, Daniel had interpreted a dream for Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar had dreamt and he could not remember the dream. Anyone here has ever had a dream? You know you had a dream, but you just, for the life of you, just could not remember the dream. Yes, that was the situation with Nebuchadnezzar. He knew he had this dream and the dream troubled him, but for the life of him, he could not remember the dream. And so he had called his wise men to, first of all, tell him what the dream was and then interpret it. Now, I am not an expert at being a reader man, and those things, but I assume that what usually happens is that you come and you tell them something, and then they will tell you what that something is supposed to mean. So, it's nothing new, it's there in scripture. The wise men from Babylon came and said, King, you know, you're unreasonable. You know how the thing works. You're supposed to tell us the dream, and then we give you the interpretation. What you're asking us to do is only the gods can do that. Come on, King, man, just work with us. Now, for those of us who know Nebuchadnezzar, he's not the kind of man to take no for an answer. He's the kind of either do it my way or your head is going to roll. And that's exactly what started to happen. You know, he pronounced a decree that all the wise men should be killed. And somehow, when it came around to Daniel, because the captain came to execute, Daniel begged and got an audience with the king. And asked for some time. And he and his friends, these three Hebrew boys, they went and they fasted. And the God of gods, the King of kings and Lord of lords, revealed the dream to them and the interpretation. Now, from that, we see Daniel and his friends were promoted. So here it is, they were in the ranks, high ranks, the aristocracy of Babylon, the social high class. The dream had been about an image whose head was gold. And that gold head represented Nebuchadnezzar's kingdom. And then there were some other parts of the image dressed, going down to the foot, that represented some other kingdom. Now, somehow Nebuchadnezzar saw that he was going to change destiny. Because you see, the image in the dream, only the head was gold. So his kingdom was only going to be for a time. When he decided that he was bigger than God and he was going to have an entire image of gold. And this is where we meet upon the boys in Daniel chapter 3. So he made this image of gold and he called all the top guys in the country, in the provinces. So you're talking about the princes. And in our terminology, MP, counselor, the big businessman, the mayor, costus, all of those, the general, major general, captain, all of those, inspector, commissioner, assistant commissioner, all of those persons were their invitation. And of course, the boys were in it because they had been promoted. Now, as I looked at it, and we know how this whole story played out. But as I looked at it, I realized that the letter was sent out, invitation. And usually when you get an invitation, it tells you what the party is about, don't it? You're being invited to a wedding, or you're being invited to a birthday party, or a baby shower, or something. It tells you what the occasion is. And I looked at it and I said, why? These guys knew what was going to happen. But they went. They went. Can I tell you, it took faith to go there in the first place. Because they would have been quite aware of what Nebuchadnezzar was capable of. They knew what they were planning to do. And they knew it could run them into some trouble. But they went anyway. How many of us know that if we travel down a path, something is going to happen, but we go anyway. We are usually trying to avoid trouble. Well, I know I don't know about you. I try to avoid some stuff. And so if it is in my power, then I avoid and stay clear. From the passage, I want to pull for us, a couple characteristics of consistent faith in uncertain circumstances. And the first one I want us to look at is that persistent faith is abounding. Persistent faith is abounding. Abounding meaning very plentiful, abundant, exists in great quantity. You know, scripture says that where sin abounds, grace does much more abound. But can I say to you that where there is or there are many witnesses, faith has to abound much more? Let me break it down for you. Some of us don't even have enough faith to stand in our little group of friends, three or four close friends you have. And you don't even have enough faith to stand when certain things are brought to you. Can you imagine the amount of faith needed to stand in a multitude? Faith has to be in abundance. I wonder for us here, if we should have someone go undercover at our workplaces, at our schools, in our classroom, wherever, in our businesses. If someone wants to go undercover, would they find you to be consistent in your faith? We can have faith when we're at church, because a lot of faithful people are around us. And so when we're on, I assume, have the same outlook when we're all gathered here. But what happens when sister and brother not standing beside you? And instead you have the neighbor or the co-worker or the classmate that you really can't stand. Does your faith abound in situations where you are not the majority? Faith had to abound for the Hebrew young men to stand for God in the midst of such important and influential people. Some of us could have talked in the church, but when we get invited to some grand occasion, and Mr. Prime Minister and Mr. Mayor, or Mr. MP and Council beside us and then talk some stuff where we know. All right. Oh, yeah. Yes. I'm talking practical stuff. Because we can speak out against some stuff when we are in church. But when we go in a some code, you know, well, you know, as long as it's not a trouble to me, as long as they don't approach me, I'm okay with it. You're not hearing anything. Faith has to be abounding so that no matter where you are and the enormity of the people and witnesses, your faith will be persistent. The bigger the challenge, the more faith should abound. The bigger the challenge, the more faith should abound. So persistent faith has to be abounded. I notice I put the present continuous in the sub-English teacher, abounding. So it means it doesn't stop. Because what happens? When you're in this situation, the faith is there. And we know how life is there. One moment you're in the frying pan, the next moment you're in the fire. So the faith has to abound between the frying pan and the fire. The next thing you know, they'll have you in a frying pan, fire, and water. And the faith has to abound to come out of those. So the faith has to be abounding. I mentioned Job. And when I can't remember all the everything about when the first messenger come, was it the sheep, the cattle? I'm not sure. But can you imagine you get that news and say, all right, God is good, you know? The Lord, you know, bless the Lord on my soul. It's just goat and cattle. And then before this man done, the next one come and say, oh, the sheep, them. And so, you know, bless the Lord. Those are just sheep and things. But then my dear one come and say your children. We know how devastating it can be to just lose. As a matter of fact, we don't even preach to the losing. Make something wrong with your child. We're not talking about that yet, you know, just something wrong. One picnic, And imagine it's not one, ten, one time. Faith had to be abounding for that man to say, the Lord gives and the Lord takes. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Persistent faith has to be abounding. But not only that, we see in verses 12, 14 to 16 that persistent faith has to be steadfast. Resolutely or dutifully firm. Steadfast. In the face of a decree and a command, the Hebrew boys were resolute. In the face and presence of an angry king, the Hebrew boys were resolute. In light of death, the young men remained resolute. Their answer indicated that they were standing firm. They said, O king, we are not careful. I don't know if you understand. You see, when they say they're not careful, they're saying, we don't even have to think about it. We don't need a moment to think. Resolute. Sometimes we make statements, but when we see the results changing against us, we change. Now some of us, we like to talk, but when we see things not working our way, we change them out. I have often said this, and you know, I'm glad the Lord got a hold of me early in life as a youngster. I think because I have Christ, my perspective on life has not been heavily, and I put heavily, influenced by the world's perspective. Because I can do without some stuff. So nobody can downgrade carrots before me and expect me to change my mind on some things. And I don't care what the outcome is. I'm not moving, not budging. I remember I was sharing one, a pastor friend of mine was mentioning something. He works in event planning. And he was saying that at times, you know, he has two vehicles, he has four kids, two vehicles. In loan and rent. And sometimes, you know, the event planning thing is not always so steady and consistent. And so sometimes he has to juggle around to pay the bills. And he says recently his boss called him and said to him, boy, I need you to do something for me. And he said, all right, boss, what is it? He says, boy, I need you to tell a little lie for me, and I'm going to give you 200 pounds for it. Four kids, rentals, car payments, struggling, new baby to solve of help, get help of his name and his kids, and 200 pounds could have stopped again. God says he didn't even think twice about it too much. He said, why pass it? And I want to go on and walk with the 20,000. Because I can't take that from you. And then Sunday they will preach. And next thing we know, you're still in front of me. I'll never talk to you. You know why some of us cannot stand and be persistent in our faith? People have things for me. And of Christian Greece, policeman Paul, when they pull him over, he's speeding. I remember I was one morning bright and early. I was coming down Discovery Bay, up by Porto Seco. Oh, I tried to obey the speed limit. I was driving a car, and well, this was a standard. And I was cruising 60 kilometers. That is the acceptable limit. But you know, I was talking with a friend of mine who was in the car, and he had a little smoke, and I just lost track of the fact that, they, you know, when we don't wind up, people go far, they don't even know. And the next thing I was doing over 70. Lo and behold, one policeman with a gun, speed gun, jump out, and flag the cross. So at the time I was working at Hillview, so I came out, took my driver's license and the papers and go to him and, you know, him have the papers and him look at my license and him. So what I said, where you coming from now? So I said, I'm coming from one thing over here. I said, yeah, what kind of work you do? And I said, I work at him. Bible college. He said, which one? I told him, I said, okay. So, still there, you know, you have that uneasy moment of quiet. So I'm waiting on my ticket, and obviously he's waiting on something else. Well, I don't normally travel with money, so he said, boy, what well, you can do for yourself? I said, well, you know, I broke the limit, so I am going to write me a ticket. You know, say, hey, you know, what's a ticket every time? I said, well, you know. So, we're there, tell you why, next thing you know, the one who stopped me, see one girl, please come and say, yo, you have to go on the move on. 135 kilometers, boy! So, this man now, bigger fish come. Give him the papers. I don't even turn. But I've been in the situation and it's not all of them stay that way. But you know, and I've heard of Christian people who did a one thing. And Pastor said, I am this kind of person. My mom is not here today, she can come. But you could probably ask her. I never used to run from being here. Because it's been around for 10 minutes of the morning. And I am like that right now. Which is probably one of the reasons I don't normally ask for help. Because if I made a decision and it got me in some hot water, me alone will stand up and take it. Already heavier than me, I have been on from the knee. We will take it and we will go, you know, help my heart, somebody. And the Lord has been having to train me and teach me that sometimes asking for help and mercy is a good thing. But at the end of the day, I am prepared to accept my consequences. Nobody is supposed to have nothing for me. Outside of the regular, because sitting there for a week, you know, I tell a little guy here, you know, a little female, sometimes, you know, so nice to people and stuff. But no one can say, we feel them thing, go on and And that's something that's at the core of my mind. When I am interacting with people, I have to think that some weirdo in the future, I might run up back into this situation and I might be trying to witness. And all of them are going to think about that. Wait. Now, in the outcome, steadfast, resolute, in this world of changing ideologies and philosophies, some of us are switching and hop skip and jumping and lining up here and there to appease and to please some people. So you know when time comes to talk the things then, some of we can't talk the things then because some of the things then have we denied. The young men could have had changed their stance when they came before the king. The king gave them the opportunity. The young men said, hold on, you know, we're not thinking about making a waste of time, hold on. Because it don't make no sense. We're not changing. We're not changing. In a relationship and for fear of losing boyfriend or girlfriend, we change our stance. Fear of losing work or job, we change our stance and position. For fear of being seen as non-progressive, many of us move from following God's will and turn to doing what we want to, and then hoping God will follow. How many of us can be steadfast, even as others, sometimes those very close to us, turn and change? Third one, persistent faith, and this might not seem to be in the line of things, but I looked at it and I said, it does fit in. Verse 16 to 18, persistent faith is respectful. Verse 16 to 18, when they were brought before the king, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If that is the case, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O king. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the golden image which you have set up. I want you to realize that's just where they said, O king. They had respect, even though they were right for standing for their faith. They were still mindful that they were in the presence of a king. Because I jumped this down. I want to make sure I get it right. Standing for what is right or your faith is no excuse to be disrespectful. Standing for what is right or your faith is no excuse to be disrespectful. You know, in today's society, people are always trying to get one up on others. And this is something I practice. I may have shared this before. We can disagree and strongly disagree, but I try my best not to get disrespectful. And you know when people get disrespectful, they start to get personal about the name calling and all sorts of stuff. They move away from the point. And I practice and I try my very best not to get disrespectful. Now, sometimes I get passionate. person sometimes would want to misread my passion for this respect. But if you should listen to my words, I try and ensure that I am still talking about the point and the person. I had an incident about 2 years back with my former employee. She was a person who, you know, she had a way to deal with people, big people like that. And I'm not saying this because it's me, but this was what everyone was saying. I like to come into a place and observe things before I get involved. And so within a couple weeks of being there, I already realized what her persona was. You know, a person sat to me before coming in to expect this. And I said to them, you know, I understand you have the experience and you have been there before, but don't tell me, let me come in and see, so that I don't make my judgment because you said. So I observed and I realized. Well, one day, Thursday afternoon after lunch, the main teachers normally go on and play PE with the boys, football. One sport everybody knows to play. Well, not really. But, so the bathroom, staff bathroom, you have to go through the office to get there. My room, where I work the computer, now you have to go through the office to get there. So my clothes was in the bathroom, my books and stuff in the computer lab, and so too was that of another teacher, main teacher. Well, the secretary normally leaves at around 3:30, school ends at 3. Well, this Friday she had to leave early. So the boss had to close up. Well, she was not going to be staying around, so she started close up. She realized all stuff and she took them and she threw them on the floor outside the office door. Just as we turned up the corner to witness it, so, you know, we came up and said, Miss, that's all the stuff we didn't have to put them, you know, there are some tables on the outside on the corner. We could have put them over there. Worse, they're not cheap. No, I'm a man, they don't have my food. How my food not touch ground? Unless it drop. I mean, 5 seconds. Because they don't stay only for 5. But, lunch kit on the floor, everything on the floor, clothes, and so we, you know, we get prepared. This lady is about 5'7". Very short. So she starts looking off. I have to leave. And I do whatever I want to. So and these are men of strong personalities. So of course the other one, you know, him stepped and then played on three conflict. The coping thing of over now. So my turn also to step up and say, what is? I have to understand. You know, we are big people and things, and if we need them to leave, we don't have a problem. Don't talk to me. Who are you? I don't want to. Yes. And she stopped going and she went, no one belongs to me. We had a couple of staff from the corner. I just everything was going on. Monday morning I come, I get a letter. Mr. Tomlinson, you were rude and disrespectful. So he take it over. Because in her book, from the moment that you speak back to her, you're old and disrespectful. How would she ask a question? You're supposed to answer. Because it's old and disrespectful. So, I am sitting on and I said, same time, one of the crew who was on the corner come in and say, in the letter, so I'm on. I said, boy, well, I'm ready for the story. And so I said, and she said, what? She said, you know, it was about 4 of them. We were around the corner and we were laughing at you. She said, look at you, big, tall, strong man. Make that little woman talk to you. So And you just run there with your sound voice. Excuse me. But I bring the point. I didn't know someone was there. I had the right to stand up for the mistreatment of my enemies. But I made sure that I did not pass my place. Look at that. You know, they call me preacher at the school, not pastor. So can you imagine? Oh, pastor, light up. The director. We can't talk to them about some answer to you know you're out of that. Faith. Persistent faith is respectful. Don't let it be that because you are right, they also say you are disrespectful. And that's something I practice. Focus on the point. If we have a problem with a point, fine. But don't get into name calling. I'm not calling you no name. You can call me any name you want. They keep focus on the point they have on the board. Not about you. Disrespect usually strays from the point. Well, if you're going to exercise consistent faith, because you know, sometimes the reason why some things that we are praying and fast about don't happen because we are being disrespectful. I wonder if you're following me. So, God is looking around and saying, hold on, all right. Yes, you need to be proud because you're a child of me, but don't use your pride to bull down and count down people. No. Because sometimes the deliverance that God is going to bring for you, sometimes the same people, yeah, disrespect, and then God not going to use what? And when you should get it today, it get delayed to the next for much months and years because the pathway that God wanted to use you not it down with your disrespect. So you don't get the chance like David to say he prepares a table in the presence of my enemies. I want you to know that what that is saying is that sometimes the very enemies are the ones that prepare the table for you. And they have to stand up and watch you eat. I think I like that. Look at that. Hey, man. And Mordecai. When the king asked Haman, what should I do to the man who is faithful? And Haman said, yes, man, exalt him. Give him a robe and put him on a horse and make somebody walking through the city and say, this is the man that the king honors. Haman says to him, set up the nice thing. And then the king said, yes, the man has an exceptional idea. Tell you what, go find Mordecai. Give him the rope, put him on the horse, and you walk him through. If you are following the story, Haman was trying to get rid of Mordecai. The enemy prepared the table and said, and even though Haman was trying to get rid of Mordecai, he never found that Mordecai was disrespectful. Moving on. Finally, persistent, consistent faith. I end with this. Must be knowledgeable. Verse 17 and 18, Daniel chapter 3. The Hebrew boys, they said, if that is the case, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fire furnace. And he will deliver us from your hand, O king. But if not, Let it be known to you, O King, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the gold image which you have set up. Now these guys had knowledge of who God was. They knew the extent of his power to deliver, but they also knew his sovereignty to make decisions that at first may seem detrimental. They were aware of what Jeremiah 29 verse 11 says, I know the plans. So sometimes God's plan is going to take you into a fire. Now, as Christians, some of us, and this is where this prosperity gospel thing coming in at times. I wouldn't even call it gospel. It's prosperity talk. Because some of us really don't still, and sad to say, probably even right here, you know, some of us still don't get the idea that while we walk on this earth, no matter how great our faith is, some of us not going to have the 5 bedroom house and the latest model car and the 5 million in the bank and the great successes at work. But many of these men and women have been going around and talking about, you don't have enough faith, that is why you're suffering and you're struggling. And I don't know if they check scripture to realize that one of the fruit of the spirit is long suffering. And my brother said, Brother Akim, if long suffering in it, how you gonna have long suffering if you don't suffer long? How is that fruit going to be born? You have to suffer long to have long suffering. And I sit and I hear Christians talking about, oh, it's my time now for my blessing. And I'm saying, hold on. So all the time before now, you never bless. Because we have this misconception to think that blessing means acquiring things. And if you don't acquire things, then they say, you're not progressive. You don't have no ambition. We can't talk and be hearing because we're not interested in running down them things. Matthew chapter 6 says, from your heart, food, clothes, shelter, what more do we want? I want to ask some of us questions because, listen, I am not against education. I tell my students all the time that if I had money, I would be a student for the rest of my life. It's good to learn. But I ask this question, some of us are in some jobs, and I want us to ask ourselves, if God put us there, are we put ourselves there? Some of us going university, I'm doing school, I'm doing degree, and I ask, did God tell you? As a matter of fact, did you check him and ask him to direct your path? Or you go to him in the park and ask him to bless it? I did CXC, I did 8 subjects. I got 5 out of the 8. 2 1s, 3 2s, 2 3s, 1 4. 1995. And I tell, up to this day, I don't know how I feel. Physics, I got a 3 in it. But such is life. I am still alive, even though sometimes we don't know where the food will come from. I still get food to eat. See, me have on clothes, they look decent. As a matter of fact, these pants might be older than some of the kids inside this room. Half of the clothes in my wardrobe I did not buy. Second hand. Big man like me, yes. Come on, guys. You know, it pains hard, you know. Like I said, I tell you something here with the people and say, you know, I'm an ambition. Because when I run down degree, I run down that, right? You know, I went to the ceremony in Kingston, and I have a sister in there. She has got her PhD, you know. And a portion of those who may think up without them masters, and who is education officer, and who is specialist. And you know, somebody came and said to me, so what are you now? Are you a principal? I said, well, you know, no, you know, but may I survive. And these are the things that have some of us fretting and can't exercise in faith. Because what we are coming to God with is nothing more than how the prepared man is praying for us. But to we people over China and China stay from being prayed. We are from God, no one is here. And I said, and sometimes it don't come and it tastes better than this. And here what I just read in PowerPoint, it says, I know how to bow and I know how to be angry. I've experienced in life. I have been where I can go out every weekend and it's pizza and KFC. I have one or two family when you go and spend time with them. They go cook. We eat Friday. All the way to the upper way. Go to a restaurant and yes. I'm going to live for a house by inside. Where food is plentiful and always available. Well, I know what to. And I have experienced life when you pull the cupboard. And I tell people, and sometimes people look at me, I tell them, I can never be out of a word. You know how big we, I can never be out of a word. You know what I say, but you need degree to advance. Sometimes I say, they have a job, you know how big we, people have that burden as work. I'm in a sicker than nobody. Look probably good. One and two years being a lot of people coming within the name of Jesus. They go on with heroes of the Lord. Sometimes I just, the pressures of life, I have to hear it up. Sometimes when I tell it right, yeah, man, my wife not going home. I know she alone, she tell me, say she cries sometimes, but I know she alone. But she will be big and, yeah, match for a team. They bought too. But we have to stay up late tonight, so we don't wake up and watch on the game. Yeah, man, sometimes she probably hear me and take some deep breath. And she think that exercise can exercise for me. But because my child hold back the tears. And I can stand here and I can tell you right now, I don't even know what tomorrow I'm going. I'm going to get some Thursday evening, Friday morning, we get up the AC and take care of work.
Good.
We probably take care of our whole team. When we come back in the evening and turn it on, turn the AC in our work. Now, Thomas and him are telling me some pull on dashboard and something. Now, anytime they hear pull on, I'm carrying money. Then the PM Friday, I'm going to tell them that done already. And the rest of the month, how it was started. So, we still come to church, we still give God thanks, and if you go out there and talk to them, then tell them all the goodness of God, save me. No, no, I try to be honest, so if you come and say everything alright, I will say no. Some alright, and we give thanks, and the rest we pray about. Real! I've been saved since 1991. I've been in the valleys. As a matter of fact, I've had more valleys than mountain top, but we're still treading, still a track. And I don't know what is going to happen tomorrow. But we don't make up my mind, so we're still going to try. Excuse me for few tears running on my face, but this is my passion. Might get lit down, but I'm not seeing them. And I want young people and all that life, everybody, because I see some people that start out in a church and do recoveries from a rapid words and then make put to one down. What we need to understand. Persistent faith, consistent faith is knowledge of the way of the understanding. When God talks about blessing, I don't necessarily know one here. So the treasures, when we are trying to score up down here, we are going to rock it. Solomon said, you work hard for your money, put it out, and you pay them a full cost one night. He said, lay for yourself treasures in heaven. Christians have become too materialistic. I mean, I'm going to pray to you, I'm going to talk. As when we talk, some people get vexed, but you know these things. Who do you care if it wear it? Because I know everybody out there is materialistic, but you know yourself. Somebody who feels that furniture will change every year. Care of it change every year. And everything where the latest copy of it. Latest fashion you have in it. Tell your story already. I had a jeans man. Buy the pants brand new. Have it for years. Knee comes down, wash out. You see the moment, the fashion when they cut out the knee coming, my pants be out. And when we cut it up, it just cut because they have it so long. Tear out. Then they have the thing when they cut out the hem on the pants and thread it. My own style whistle out, so they just finish it. And have it. And they look like me in a fashion, but me have the pants now tight. We never have to go buy it. My wife knows selling at a man into the fashion thing. Sometimes I frustrate her because she thinks I could look a little more handsome. But I refuse. Because I tell this even to my students. Because I have a lot of boys in my class. And they need to football big. And every day, they want a messy jersey. I run out in your name, Mark. And we said to them, it's not the clothes make the man, it's the man make the clothes. But don't I run long jersey because not me, I don't want it, because we see the man wear it while we want it. So we said, why don't you be someone to create Alleghese kwa na nomba. I'm going to close, guys. I know some people watching in time. But I tell you, I was going to get emotional because I've sat down and these are things I've been thinking about. And when I look at scripture, I want you all, you're all in here right now. And I want us to think about it. What if all of us in here were billionaires? How would that work out? Huh? If all of us had 15 PR and the biggest house, well, obviously, no, now we can't have the biggest house if all of us have the biggest house. How would that work out? So why is it that we're thinking that is what God has put on and keep up for us? You know, I have observed, and some of the most contented people in Christendom are the people who don't have much. You ever go sit down with the little old lady? Sisters, I'm not here. Sisters, I'm carrying a big car or whatever. Do you ever go sit down and talk with her? We tell God seven of our rich. Not because I think that I might go astray. But I want you to understand this when you have to check in every for the parents. You ever notice the difference between the child or the parent, the all their lunch money for the month, separate from the one who have to come every day to get it. Every morning. You ever realize that sometimes they pick it in, they go talk to their parents because they know, say they already get their lunch money. So when they're ready to make some money and that, they know really can't serve or come to make it up because they already have the lunch money for the month. And when the month soon, they come, no one child here and daddy are on the good side. But the one who have to come every day and make sure, say my mommy and daddy are in a good standing. So that every day you come and get it. And sometimes we're going to have to do that with some of us. Make sure that it keep us beside it. Because if it keeps us, we don't have it more. Talking about persistent faith in uncertain circumstances. None of us here know what tomorrow brings. Well, except for one thing, for those of us who know Christ, tomorrow can always bring us closer to Him. As I close, if you are here today, you don't know Christ, you can't talk about persistent faith. That's why I know some of you like the disciples in the boat, rocking to and fro, trying to do your little thing to be on the water when I come in on the ship. Trying to do your own little thing. Some of us Christians is the same thing too. We are forgotten that Jesus is right here. Consistent faith requires us to be knowledgeable. We need to know God. So if you're here today, all eyes closed and go. I'm going to talk to those who are here. You know within yourself, you don't know Jesus Christ as personal Lord and Savior. And you might be listening and say, well, you're a Christian and you have a rough life. You don't watch that. 70 years of rough life cannot be compared to an eternity with Christ. I'm a mathematician and I can tell you that there is no comparison. Some of us will even get the full 70. But you are here today in turmoil. Faith today, not tomorrow. For the unsaved, you think you're exercising faith, but your faith is in the things that you have control over. The first place you need to look is Jesus Christ. If you don't know him today and you want to come to that saving knowledge of Christ, where you are, could you just raise your hand? Someone will be willing to point you to Christ. You don't know Christ. You cannot have persistent faith without Christ. Because your faith has to be anchored in him, the one who never changes. Even when your circumstances change, God is still the same. I move to my Christian brothers and sisters. We've allowed our perspective to be pulled to different sides by what the world thinks. And ultimately what has happened is that we have allowed our faith to be pulled at place in the opinions of men and the things of this world instead of resting on Jesus Christ. Again, I say, like the disciples are in the boat being tossed about, but we have forgotten that Jesus was the one that called us into the boat. And not only that, he is in the boat with us in the storm. Christians, aren't you tired to hear and say to us, we of little faith? If you want that persistent faith in uncertain circumstances, I pray I will raise your hand and I pray for you as I pray for myself. And come on me, whatever the circumstance. And I want us to realize that persistent faith, and I left this one off because of that. Persistent faith is realistic. It means that it looks at what is happening around. These guys knew they were real. They said, listen, we're standing and we know the reality of the situation is that God can deliver us. The other reality is that he can cause us to burn up in the fire. But whether or not either of those realities come to pass, we are still going to stand steadfast in faith for him. Christian, we must be realistic. God can choose to deliver us, or he may choose to cause us to burn, feel some hurt, feel some pain. But if you have knowledge of who he is, then you will know that whatever he allows is working for our good. It's on those hands. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, for the truth that is there. Lord, I thank you for having encouraged my heart also, as this word was not just for them, but for me. me as well, to remind me that I need to be steadfast, that I need to be respectful, knowledgeable, if I'm to be consistent with my faith. Lord, I want to pray for those who have raised their hands, who have said, Lord, we want to have that persistent faith, even in circumstances that are uncertain. Father, we know the road is rocky, the hills are steep, but we know that you will provide for us our needs. And if you don't provide a way out, you will provide a way for us to bear it. Help us to be realistic in our faith, to know that you are sovereign. And in the end, you will do what you think is needed for us to grow. Father, again, thank you for your word and for speaking to our hearts. But above all, I pray that even as we have heard from you, that we will not go away today being just hearers of your word, but help us to be doers also, lest we deceive ourselves. Be with us now, in Jesus' name.